Good evening, oh. Good evening, oh. Good evening, oh. All right. I would like to be speaking, or I would like to speak on a very interesting subject this evening, and that is embracing radical ideas for accelerated advancement. And it's really important to touch on this because as a community, as a people, even as a species, as a race, we are sometimes averse to the idea of or to the concept of radical ideas. We choose to sometimes to fight rather than, you know, investigate and embrace. So I would start out with the idea of technology, as it were. This is something that has helped our society, not just on a local scale, but on a global scale, advance and evolve. And it has done it in such a way that if technology does it right, one of the things that it achieves in the life of the user is that it makes it almost impossible for us to imagine what life was like before we began to use that bit of innovation. Take, for instance, the ways that we transport ourselves now, or the ways that we communicate, or just imagining something as little or as simple as life before the internet or before telephones became a thing. How did we communicate? How was communication, you know, carried out without? It's just almost impossible to imagine that. And so when technology comes and it does its bit correctly, it forces us. It not only causes us, but it forces us to advance and to evolve as a society. But then we all know that technology is not perfect. But the reason that we embrace it anyway is because it makes our lives so much easier and much more convenient. It offers us more convenient ways of doing things. And so we can sometimes overlook its imperfections. And when we talk about imperfections, within this context, what we're basically talking about is the parts and the elements of the human experience that is not captured by a particular generation or dispensation of technology. And one of that parts, or one of those parts of human experience or elements of human experience, is trust. Now, trust is something that is very central to human interaction, very central. And in an age where social interaction is being redefined by the media, and how we interact is constantly changing. We are not just texting now, we are enjoying communications via video. And we can also see more advancements with mixed reality, virtual reality. It's changing. These disruptions are coming slow and steady, but they're coming anyways. Now, as we move into the future, one of the things that is going to be central to a future where we are getting more and more interconnected with people from all over the globe is the idea of trust. Before I welcome somebody into my space, how can I know that I trust this person? I was having a chat with a friend of mine who lives in Poland yesterday, and I mentioned that it's such a strange thing to imagine that we've never actually seen each other and we've been friends for years. And it's like, how do you build trust like that? I'm thinking in my head, does the fact that this person is also an influencer help me to trust them more? Because when I think about how we have connected and how I've been able to trust them with certain amounts of money, that as an Igbo man, I wouldn't do that. I don't know whether you're understanding, but they've helped me clear. So as a content creator and someone who makes money online, one of the challenges that we face is, you know, remittances, how to make sure that the money that you earn here and here gets back to your Naira bank account. And sometimes it's tricky dealing with foreign fintechs. So as somebody who lives abroad, she's helped me collect some very substantial amounts of money and then hold it for me till I have need for it. And it's like, how? We've known each other 3 years. How did we connect on that level? And how did we get to trust each other like that? But even though that's an outlying case, how do we replicate trust on a larger scale where, as we are meeting people, you're chatting with somebody and you guys have chatted for a long time and you are planning marriage, you are discussing marriage, and you guys have never seen each other. And these are things that happen these days that were so strange 10, 20 years ago, right? And they will continue to happen at an increasing rate as we enter into the future. So trust is something that technology has to help us with or has to develop a scheme for. And that is an area that I may be touching on very specifically today. I'll give you an instance that will help push the point. I was in my home about 4 years ago, maybe three years ago now, and a friend called me. He was sounding quite frantic over the phone. And what was the issue? He was saying, please, I want to know if you know anybody that can help us. What happened? It was a local politician, a local government chairman or so, that came to their gate, came to the estate, and came to that particular, maybe looked around and saw that I can't drag land with this person, I can't drag with this one. Okay, this one looks like people that don't know people, right? Knocked there and presented documents that he purchased this land 2-3 years ago, and that now he wants to start. He's discovered that you guys are living here. And these people have owned this land probably since 1991 or 1992. He's been in the family. And so it became a case of who knows who more, rather than a case of documentation, because they had serious connections and they seemed to present documentations that were to some degree credible. At the end of the day, documentation did not win. What determined the outcome of that was who is more connected, who has more pool, who knows more people. And we see that happen very, very often in our day-to-day. How do we tackle some of these challenges? And that is where I strongly believe, that the idea of blockchain technology is something that we as a people, especially in this part of the world, must become more and more conversant with. And the problem is, when we hear about ideas like this, we look at it from the point of view or from the perspective of what has been popularized. And when you look at the idea of it from that perspective, it's almost as if blockchain technology is all about cryptocurrencies, and cryptocurrencies is all about those who have traded it, and all that negative PR that comes from that light. Effectively, on a very basic level, what blockchain technology talks about, or what a block is within that context, a block is a data structure that stores data and is only complete when you collect information that was stored in the block before it. I'll give you an example. So if this is a block, a lot of transactions are made, people interact, and data concerning those interactions are stored inside that block. Now, for us to conclude that block and make it into a thing, like determine that this is closed, no more transactions can enter in, we need to generate an identifier for that block. Let's call it an ID number. Now, the next block that will be created requires the ID of the last block in order to be able to find, you know, create its own ID. So in that sense, the IDs of these different blocks are all necessary for the next one to be formed. So they are all interlinked in that sense. Now, why this technology is so fascinating, and I find it very interesting, is because it gives us a way to be able to verify information with extreme accuracy, trusting that the information that is stored on a blockchain cannot at any point in the future be altered. Because for you to alter the information that's stored on a block in a blockchain, what you have to do is you have to change the data on one block. And when you change the data on one block, it alters the ID of that block. And so everything that comes after that block is messed up, right? And so this technology, that's on a very basic level, gives us an insight into what is possible when we begin to embrace radical ideas like this in the building of the future, or as we begin to develop products and services that will serve us in the future. Now, if you listen to my definition of what a blockchain is, you will understand that it is fundamentally, at its very basis, a data structure. It's for storing data. And so it comes into play at every level where data needs to be stored, needs to be trusted, and can easily be verified. It's transparent. And when you look at society today, we have a lot of systems that require that kind of an infrastructure. In academia, we store information, and you don't need, maybe when you're applying for school somewhere abroad, you don't need to go to Abuja and go and stand to verify that you wrote WAEC in 2013 so that on all that, it's easily accessible and we can trust it just by looking at the data that's stored on the blockchain. We use that in academics. We can use that in healthcare. We can use that, obviously, when we go to cast votes on a ballot. And then we are sure that the infrastructure, the way that it is designed, it cannot be tampered with. Now, the reason I am singling this out in a lecture that is supposed to address radical ideas is simply because it's not just about blockchain itself. It's about these ideas that seem to challenge the norm, ideas that seem to be offensive in some way, maybe because of the PR that it has or because of ways that people have used it. We now seem to be averse to the idea of it. But if we are going to think global and really go global, then we must be interested in these radical pieces of ideas, because as we are in what people would call the developing world, we need radical ideas to be able to make radical leaps if the world is going to come to us. Look at, for instance, what China has done with an infrastructure like this. As far back as 2014, which is 5 years after the Bitcoin blockchain, after the Bitcoin white paper was released, they started formally looking into it. And by 2016, they had their first dedicated research institute, just dedicated to the idea of the blockchain. By 2020, they had started testing across three major cities. They had processed over $160 million across 3.1 million transactions just in that time frame. And right now, it's spread to over 20 cities. This is the behavior of a people who are looking to be central to a future where they believe that everybody is coming to. And if we are going to be central to a future, and when I say a future, I'm looking beyond just finance, even in social interaction, as we move into the world of, you know, mixed reality and neural links and all these, you know, things that are designed to keep us connected. We need to be able to connect with somebody. As we are connecting with them, we are able to see what their history looks like and what their activity looks like, what, you know, the track record that they have in a way that we know has not been tampered with. Ideas like this are very significant and will be very critical to the future of human interaction and of the human society at large. And if we're going to be, like I said before, central, we're going to need to position ourselves in a way that when the world finally wakes up and begins to inevitably chase after these ideas, we have developed infrastructures and systems that can be beneficial to the world at large. What we need to do right now is, instead of just discarding, we must investigate what these ideas look like. And we must be open to entertaining these ideas instead of overregulating some of the ideas that the very future of our race and our community, our society, is dependent upon. Thank you very much.